and go directly to on-chip decoupling. So I already mentioned that very often we are placing decoupling capacitors next to the IC between the VDD and ground pin. But it also would make sense not just to place an external capacitor, but to place the capacitor also inside of the chip. But in this case, we are talking then about on-chip decoupling. Okay. Yeah, basic principle about on-chip decoupling. So this is the situation without any kind of on-chip decoupling. So we have the power supply pin, the lead frame, the bond wire. We are going to the bond bed and then into this metal ring around the chip, and from the metal ring we are driving some supply rails into the core logic. And in the core logic we have some gates, like inverter gates, which are driven. Then out of the VSS supply rail we are then going back to ground. So the current is flowing, dynamic switching current and crowbar current, out of VDD as a current spike into VDD rails, across the CMOS inverter and then out of the chip. By placing a decoupling capacitor next to this inverter, for example, we can try to force the current to circle around in this loop here. So we are using the charge that is stored in the capacitor so that the high frequency current due to the switching activity, the crowbar current, always comes mainly out of the capacitor. And when we are increasing implementing additional resistances to increase the charging of the capacitor, because we have to recharge the capacitor anyway, we can also get rid of this big current spikes on the power supply. So we only have the current spikes here in this small loop, so small loop, small parasitic inductance, small magnetic field that is coming out. If we do not have this capacitor, we have this big loop, and the big loop means usually a lot of electromagnetic emissions. So the trick is to place the decoupling capacitors in a strategic way there where quite a lot of switching activity is generated. Yeah, I also did a test chip together with my colleagues in order to figure out how much improvement can we have when we are using empty spaces that are available in the chip anyway and fill these empty spaces with decoupling capacitors. And in a chip, there are very often not many empty spaces, but there are some. So here you can see our test chip without any on-chip decoupling, OCD. And in our test chip, there was a lot of space, so we have filled every empty spot as good as possible. Usually the empty spots are the corner cells, here, 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 here. So the corner cells are just there to connect the metal rings here and the metal rings there. So there is just metal over there. And below the metal, there is usually, or in the old technology, there was nothing. Okay, then also in between the cells, so for example, I don't know, this is an input cell, this was the LVDS input structures, this is an whatever output driver cell, this was the VDD cell, this was the ground cell. Between the cells, there are also empty spaces. And we also have then finally filled up these empty spaces, these filler cells, or the spacer cells, then with on-chip decoupling. Yeah, and this was then the test chip. So you can see, compared to this one, now all these empty spaces below the metal lines are filled with on-chip decoupling capacitors. Yeah, what kind of on-chip decoupling capacitor have we used? So any idea what capacitor can be integrated into an integrated circuit? Yeah, metal-to-metal capacitors. So the first task was to figure out what kind of capacitor is the best for on-chip decoupling. Where can I get most capacitance on the smallest available space? And which capacitor is then the most robust one? Because it's also about electrostatic discharges and RF interferences or something. So here again, made a literature research in order to figure out what are other IC manufacturers doing in order to increase on-chip decoupling. And let's talk a little bit about this on the blackboard. So the most promising capacitor was the gate capacitor, because at the gate capacitor we can get very high capacitance values at a small area size. But the problem is, if you are connecting from VDD to VSS, and this is what we want this capacitor between VDD and VSS, a capacitor directly, for example, in this way, we are connecting the drain and the source here, and the gate, for example, here. Or we can also do it in the other way. So we can also connect drain and source here, and the gate there. This is very good because we have this capacitor here between VDD and ground, or VDD and VSS also here. But what could be the drawback when you're doing this in this way? Either in that way or in that way, doesn't matter. Think of electrostatic discharges. So very often can happen if you are touching the IC, you are discharging into the IC pins, maybe directly into the VDD pin, could be, then I think it's clear, we have this electrostatic discharge here, and very often ESD goes to ground, so therefore there is some current. But if you are also discharging into an input pin, then very often the basic ESD protection structure that is protecting the input are just diodes, one diode to VDD and one diode to ground, and depending if the ESD bias is positive or negative, the ESD bias directly goes into the input and then over the diode to VDD if it's positive. And then on the VDD rail, you have this bias. And somewhere the bias will also see the gate capacitance. And as this gate is not then very good protected, and the gate is usually very thin, it can easily break. Yeah, and then you have a kind of, in the worst case, a short circuit between VDD and VSS, and then your chip is not operating anymore. And in the worst case, the whole system is catching fire. Okay, so what we did was, we have to use the gate because the gate is very cool, but we were implementing then some resistors here or there to protect then the gate because we are limiting the current. But the resistor also has a drawback because it's not that small anymore. It's quite big, and so unfortunately not we, but another engineer from Eindhoven came up with a very nice idea. He was combining these two structures in a very nice way. VDD and VSS, and I hope I can draw it now in the right way. He used one transistor here. Yeah, so the other one there. So I gotta draw it. So like this. And I think this is a very clever way to do it, because he got rid of all these resistors, this one and this one, between VDD and ground. He has one capacitance, here another capacitance. But the cool thing is, as these transistors are clustered in this way together, this transistor here is protecting the gate here, because here is the on resistance, and the on resistance is acting as a resistor to protect the gate. And this transistor here is acting as an on resistance in order to protect this gate. And I think this is the most efficient way to provide on-chip decoupling on a very small space. Yeah. And exactly this structure was then, in an optimized way, placed in this test chip. So this is how my on-chip decoupling structure looked like. This is the layout, and this small thing here is one of this spots here. So we made a kind of unique cell, which was placed then as often as possible in these corner cells, and then also in the spacer cells, and also within the core logic between the other gates at the empty spaces at the filler cells. Yeah, we were also developing a kind of software tool that was then finally removing all the empty spaces and placing all these decoupling capacitor cells and also calculating how much total on-chip decoupling you have. So it was calculating, okay, four times the corner cells, each corner cell has, I don't know, 50 femtofarads or whatever, and 10 spacer 100 cells and 5 spacer 50 cells and 50,000 filler cells, and it was already calculating how much additional on-chip decoupling in nanofarads or whatever you will get. Okay, so we were mainly interested in how big is now the reduction of the electromagnetic emission when we are filling all the empty spaces. So we also made DEM cell tests. And yeah, here is the result without on-chip decoupling, and this was the result with the on-chip decoupling. You can see that in our case, the reduction was about 14 dB in a certain frequency range. Okay, so question to the audience, is this the best way to do it? Well, it didn't cost anything because the empty spaces are there anyway. Now just the empty spaces are filled with capacitances. So if I'm asking you in this way, then probably the answer is no. From my perspective, it's not really the best way because, as I said, we should place the decoupling capacitors in a more strategic way, especially there where the electromagnetic emission is generated, to keep the electromagnetic emission or the generation of the electromagnetic emission as local as possible. So on the one hand, if we are filling up all these spaces with gates, we are ending up with a very big gate area. And in the process step, depending on the process that you have, the gate oxide is not always very stable and very robust. So the more gate areas and the gate oxide you have, you can also get more problems with gate defects due to the manufacturing process. So this might be one drawback when you're filling up everything with gate capacitances. Another topic is, we already talked about parasitic inductances. Now we are placing capacitances, and there are also inductances. So we're also generating resonant circuitries. And if you're just placing the capacitors in a not very intelligent way, you are generating quite a lot of different resonance frequencies. So it could happen that you're ending up with a certain frequency range where your IC is really resonating. And this could happen that then the power supply is also resonating up and down at a certain frequency range, which is not really contributing to the robustness of your IC. So therefore, we should also include some resistances to damping, or to damp the currents, as I've shown you before, in the entrance points where we are going then from the metal traces into the core logic. There would be a good location for placing resistors, for example.